A staggering 1.6 billion tons of food is wasted around the world every year. One-third of all the food produced for human consumption. Berlin-based SPRK.global's founder and CEO Alexander Piutti believes new breakthrough in data, AI, and exchange can come to the rescue. For its audacious plan, SPRK was the winner of the Smart Cities and Transportation category for this year's Extreme Tech Challenge competition. Thanks for joining our session. Can we save world's food supply? So, good morning.
Good morning, Jan.
Thanks for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
Often, these impact business looked at it as a social service. But actually what you're trying to do is creating a marketplace.
Yes.
And being able to provide marketplace where you can be able to manage imbalance in supply and demand.
Yes.
And namely, the imbalance is there are a lot more food that are produced that are consumed. And in the other side, there are many people that need food. They cannot get it at the right quality and right price and right time.
Yes.
So in many ways, you're trying to solve that problem. So tell us a little bit about how big is the problem and how much food is wasted in a year. You said Berlin as an example. Yeah. What is the opportunity we're talking about here?
Yeah. So, okay. So we're talking about food waste and food waste solution. And we all know it's not just a local problem, it's a global problem. Mm-hmm. Yeah, like it happens anywhere in the world. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and as you correctly pointed out, it's you know, it, simply explained, it's, you know, like an overcapacity of food which does not find the right demand on time. Yeah, because food is perishable. So, you know, timing is an important factor, yeah, to say, like, how can I redistribute this oversupply very quickly into the right channels. Yeah. So let's call it a distribution problem or a distribution challenge. Mm-hmm. And so we think at SPRK we've cracked conceptually the problem, because if you combine a rapid local redistribution, potentially in combination with a production, because like you need to transform that food into a meal or something else, but at the same time to integrate and involve existing forces and players, especially NGOs, yeah, to build such an ecosystem and not just a startup or not just a technology, but the answer we find is a very powerful distribution platform, and this is our home turf, as techies, to instill this platform into the supply chain while integrating, you know, all existing parties. Especially NGOs, yeah, to make sense of this oversupply.
So could I use eBay as an example? And it may not be quite right, but you know, in many ways, eBay did have the balance between supply and demand. You know, the people that had this leftover table, they didn't know what to do with, or sofa, whatever, when they're moving. And it enabled people to find and then being able to get that in a one-on-one way. But now what you're trying to do is a massive amount of produce that are not one, but millions of tons of food that could come out in one angle that are not wasted. Yeah. Two NGOs that requires 100,000 people, 50,000 people that requires the consumption. And so in some ways, this is a even bigger scale of complexity and challenges than maybe what eBay has done. But it is kind of marketplace there in some ways. You look at that as a platform to enable that. Yeah. And then with the being able to have a large scale with timeliness, right? Because food does get spoiled. So if you can buy it and sell it in a year, that's not a big deal. But if you have to do it within 24 hours,
there you go.
That's a big deal, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
So tell me about how. What is the technology? What is the platform you're using to enable the scalability, the robustness, the sustainability, and as well as making sure it's efficient?
Right. So, yeah, right on. You mentioned a couple of really powerful examples like eBay. let me try to like remember all your questions and so I can go one by one. So eBay, they have obviously done an amazing job to build such a platform, yeah? But let's call it an open platform, yeah? Yeah. So I can be a supplier, I can be a demand person, yeah? But you know, it's obvious for anybody, basically, yeah? So that doesn't work when it comes to food, mm-hmm. yeah? Because the food suppliers, producers, traders, they want to be protected. Yeah, mm-hmm. I cannot produce a channel conflict and say, hey, I have 4 tons of meat. Yeah, mm-hmm. I just put it into like an open marketplace mm-hmm. and it's up for grabs, right? So I would immediately produce a channel conflict, mm-hmm. which cannot be the answer. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the answer is like a controlled distribution mechanism. So we empower these suppliers with a set of rules like mm-hmm. blacklist, whitelist, you know, what should I do? What may I do? What I shouldn't do? Yeah. So, and basically we are the extended workbench of the supply partners, and we do exactly what they tell us. Mm-hmm. Yeah? So for example, they say, okay, these 4 tons of meat, for example, of course you can produce these ingredients into like meals, yeah? And then, you know, it disappears and it goes back into society. It's a circular concept, right? Mm-hmm. Or they tell us, well, in some instances you may sell it, yeah? But we want to know to whom you sell it because we want to avoid a channel conflict, yeah? Mm-hmm. So let's call it a moderated, controlled platform to protect the supply chain. But you know, it's obvious we partner with them as opposed to we go against them. Yeah? Right. So it's a partner model, which refers to SDG number 17 from UNEP, which you know reminds us to think in alliances and partnerships. Mm-hmm. Yeah, SDG 17 is all about partnerships. And that's the answer, to say like it's a hyper-local approach. Of course, we have to crack the problem in Berlin and other cities. But we also, you know, extend our platform when we scale to other countries and other parties like NGOs, yeah? And we're talking to these NGOs already because we've been active and live for 12 months now. Mm-hmm. It's very hard for NGOs to build such a technology by themselves. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not their home turf. You know, they don't have the capital, they don't have the know-how, mm-hmm. but it would, you know, make all the sense in the world to say, let's understand their requirements, mm-hmm. yeah, and give them even more power and more efficiency through our platform. So we connect the dots between supply and demand.
Mm-hmm. So, you've been now doing it for a while, and I know you are self-funded, and it's a very difficult time to start the company in a way when people really cannot be able to move. So I'm really curious about, as a startup company in this pandemic period, how do you manage, how do you work with your team, how do you even work with partners, and have you been, and you said actually you've been actually ramping your business. So just curious about how you're doing that.
Yeah, so, you know, my experience tells me to look out for, let's call them champions, individual people who connect with the mission and say, hey, maybe I can contribute to that mission. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I've orchestrated these people into mm-hmm. a team and extended team and a powerful advisory board. Mm-hmm. to build momentum for the idea, mm-hmm. yeah? But mm-hmm. When it comes to funding, I've also been careful not to reach out to people to fund the business too early mm-hmm. before we validate the assumptions, yeah? So, and the core assumption is, are we able to really tap into that supply? Mm-hmm. Yeah? Everyone knows food waste is a massive problem, yeah? Mm-hmm. Theoretically, but practically, mm-hmm. are we able to construct these relationships with these people and build mm-hmm. trust? Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it's a difficult topic. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the answer is yes. Yeah, so and that took us a while, and we also needed to validate the assumption. Say, you know, so what happens with that supply? Even if we get our hands on these crazy amounts of oversupply, mm-hmm. what then happens on the demand side? Yeah, do we have enough demand so we can redistribute? Basically, is there a possibility for a business model, yeah? For example, NGOs, are they willing to pay, let's say, half of the price they're used to? Mm-hmm. And the answer is yes. Yeah? So all these core assumptions mm-hmm. we need to validate mm-hmm. before we actually scale and ramp up, and here we are.
So good. So what you're really saying, a couple of things for startup CEOs, you know, when you want to start something, having the champions
yeah.
make it easier to get at least tested some yes. of your concept. And then obviously you have to always think about go-to-market model.
Yes.
Where the customers are and how do you connect those two dots. And it sounds like you have established enough of those testing where you can be able to go to the next stage of scaling.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yes, we've cracked these assumptions and we have access to that supply. Now, when it comes to COVID-19, for example, and you will get the complexity, yeah, you have a B2B supply chain, which mm-hmm. produces into gastronomy, hotels, restaurants, yeah, which have no business right now, yeah, mm-hmm. because people mm-hmm. don't go to restaurants, they right. don't go right. to hotels. Yeah. So that B2B supply chain into these B2B players is stalled. Yeah, but however, you know, that food is produced, yeah, mm-hmm. so there's massive oversupply.
Right.
Now, on the B2C side, yeah, where you have retail and supermarkets and people like us mm-hmm. going shopping, basically, yeah, there's a deficit because, you know, sometimes you don't find pasta and yeah. But to balance this oversupply on the B2B side mm-hmm. and you know, the deficit on the B2C side, even more for NGOs, mm-hmm. you already get, you know, there's a huge potential to tap into 1.6 billion tons of food waste per year. So we think about it not as a problem. You know, we're intrigued because we like to think in solutions mm-hmm. as entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. And having, you know, cracked these assumptions, basically, we are very motivated to now pull forward, you know, build our technology. And on the technology side, we don't want to just redistribute mm-hmm. and say we can rescue everything that would potentially be wasted. No, we want to move from rescue to avoid. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but we first need to rescue and be a partner mm-hmm. to the supply guys to then work with them over the next couple mm-hmm. of years mm-hmm. to move into the individual use cases why things get wasted mm-hmm. and move into avoid. And that's the solution. Yeah, mm-hmm. and so the technology plays a huge role to predict these cases, yeah, not just in real time to say, I can pick up some food mm-hmm. here and there, mm-hmm. but to learn about these patterns, mm-hmm. yeah, and to learn about, you know, how can we predict these cases because they naturally move like in patterns.
So it's a bit like using AI to do yes. predictive analytics.
Absolutely.
And then being
Absolutely.
Able to do a proper forecasting.
Absolutely.
And so that when you do that, then you can be able to match supply demand in a much more efficient way, yeah. and they will, at the end of the day, less waste. Right, and
Absolutely.
To do it requires a circular partnership ecosystem, and you know people are using this idea of circular economy now quite a bit everywhere, and which is what you mean by ecosystem and partners.
Yes, yeah, and you know the interesting challenge is not just the circular concept on the B2B side, mm-hmm. you know, moving from suppliers into NGOs. Mm-hmm. Let's call that B2B,
right?
Yeah? But also to integrate the consumers, yeah, because more than 40% of food waste occurs on the consumer side, yeah, to work with education and say how can these cases be avoided, you know, how to do a better forecast, how to quickly redistribute if we need to, yeah. But it becomes clear technology is the answer while working with these champions to like mm-hmm. understand their use cases, build trust, and then really crack the problem.
All right. Well, you know, the I'm also extremely happy that your company applied for competition, which we call Extreme Tech Challenge, which I started with my another kitesurfing buddy,
okay,
and Bill Tai. And at the time when we started, it was really about helping athletes to achieve their personal performance better through technology. But as you know, about 18 months ago at VivaTech in France, we decide to convert that into tech for good and really decide to focus our energy around finding companies that are supporting UN 17 sustainability.
Yeah.
Why do you think we should select you as the winner, one of the finalists for this competition?
Yeah. So I guess now it's pitch time.
Yeah, it's a pitch time, yes. No,
but jokes aside, you know, technology or tech for good, as we call it, mm-hmm. Is something quite new, to say, to build exactly that bridge between professional forces like, you know, Samsung and the startup scene, and then also other parties. Traditionally, you know, the world has worked in silos, you know, the NGOs are a silo and, you know, the commercial world is a silo. Mm-hmm. Our job as tech entrepreneurs, including Extreme Tech Challenge, mm-hmm. is to build solid bridges between mm-hmm. those silos, mm-hmm. yeah, because we need either party, not just mm-hmm. one, yeah. And, As I explained, you know, we believe as tech entrepreneurs into technology to really crack the problem. Mm-hmm. But it's not just the technology. It's more like people starting to think in alliances. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so my pitch is really to say we are happy to take the lead on the idea and solution side. Mm-hmm. But obviously, we can't do this by ourselves. Right. Like we need to pull in SAP and Microsoft and all these great mm-hmm. guys, IBM, to build the technology with us together, because we need to connect to the supply chain and pull in these people together, so we can orchestrate the approach, but we need people like Samsung and other ones to really be successful.
I think that is actually why we decide to create a competition that are not traditional competition. We're just looking at startups.
Yeah.
But in the eyes of creating a highway, communication and partnership between corporations and startups, so that we can go much faster together than doing it alone. Because you're right, great ideas come from startups. They take risk, people like you, and great ideas come from anywhere.
Yes.
And so their corporations tend to have a machinery, and machinery tend to have a limited way to do things, but they're very good at and efficient. So if we can connect those two dots, then we can create highway of ideas to get to the go-to-market in a much faster way. And that was the idea behind this partnership. Alex, I really appreciate your time and you're willing to be also part of our partnership discovery process.
Absolutely.
It can help us navigate in a place like Berlin, where we have not done a lot in the past, but we are planning to do more.
Yeah.
And I really appreciate that ability to build a network through people like you who've been doing it for time. And also what you're doing is very exciting. I'm wishing you the very best for your impact investment with success, which I believe success will bring more success.
Yeah. Thank you very much. I feel honored.
Thank you.
And we will continue. Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
Thanks a lot, Alex. Yeah, appreciate it.